Welcome to World Action and Reaction News. Today's news headlines are, one of the frontline fighters of the Indian Air Force, the Jaguars, are still flying without autopilots, an essential flying aid, the controller and auditor general has said. In a report presented in Parliament on July 28, the CAG said, the flying aid capability envisaged by the IAF for the Jaguar aircraft in 1997 remains largely unrealized even after 20 years. Meanwhile, the IAF had lost three Jaguar aircraft and one pilot since April 2008 due to pilot disorientation / human error, whereas loss of another four Jaguar aircraft was under investigation as of October 2016. An autopilot reduces the pilot's workload, enhances safety of aircraft and cuts aircraft accidents. Jaguars acquired in the 1980s are of older vintage and lack autopilots. In 1997, the IAF had projected a requirement of 108 autopilots for 108 aircraft, but only 35 autopilots were contracted in August 1999 due to resource crunch at a cost of 37.42 crore, which were delivered between 2006 and 2008. A repeat contract for 95 autopilots was concluded only by March 2014. Suboptimal function: out of 35 autopilots procured earlier, only 18 could be integrated on the Jaguar aircraft as of March 2017. The integrated autopilots were also functioning suboptimally due to malfunctioning of their vital component, i.e. autopilot electronic unit, APEU, the report said. The Department of Atomic Energy's efforts to forge joint ventures with PSUs for building foreign nuclear reactors in the country has received a setback, with the railways declining its offer to enter a partnership for the purpose, a senior government official has said. The railways has not cited any reason for refusing to collaborate with the Nuclear Power Corporation of India Limited, NPSIL, a PSU under the DAE, the official said. The NPSIL operates 22 nuclear reactors in the country with a total capacity of 6,780 MW. Under the proposal, the DAE had also offered to sell electricity to the railways, but the national carrier did not find it lucrative. The official, who requested anonymity, said the railways was looking for capital for its own expansion and they seemed unwilling to divert their resources. The NPSIL has also entered joint ventures with the National Aluminium Company Ltd., NALCO, the Indian Oil Corporation Ltd., IOCL, and the National Thermal Power Corporation, NTPC. However, even the response from these companies has not been very forthcoming, the official pointed out. With VK Singh meeting U.S. Secretary of State Rex Tillerson in Manila on the sidelines of the ASEAN Foreign Ministers meeting, it caps a week of renewed engagement between India and the U.S. It comes at a time when the Trump administration is working on a South Asia policy to deal with one of the longest and most difficult wars in Afghanistan. Senior-ranking officials from State, Pentagon, and National Security Council were in India this week to participate in a 1.5-track dialogue organized by the MEA and think tank Ananta Center. Alice Wells, Acting Assistant Secretary for South Asia, Lisa Curtis, Senior Director in NSC, and Kara Abercrombie from the Pentagon met Foreign Secretary Jay Ishankar and NSA Ajit Doval, among others. There is bad news for those Facebook warriors in India thirsting for a war with China and Pakistan. The Controller and Auditor Generals, CAG, report on the Indian Army submitted to Parliament has some significantly disturbing findings. Despite all its bravery, our army is battling with a drastic shortfall of necessary arsenal. The report is a follow-up to the conclusions of May 2015. Its objective was to evaluate the progress that has been made over the last 3 years. The CAG report on ammunition management reveals that the situation in September 2016 has not changed much since March 2013. The standoff between Chinese and Indian troops in the Doklam area, at the tri-junction with Bhutan, is accompanied by competing narratives, attempts to clarify, justify, or rationalize their positions. These are aimed at multiple audiences, especially third countries that know little about the details of the problem. The Chinese have been far more active with a series of official statements, which have been getting progressively tougher towards India. The nub of the Chinese position, set out at length in their latest statement, is that Indian troops have crossed a settled international boundary and entered Chinese territory. This needs some historical perspective. Is the Doklam area assuredly Chinese territory? Hardly. China claims the area, but it is disputed by Bhutan. And the two sides have had 24 rounds of talks. While most Indians perceive the conflict with China only in military terms, Beijing achieved its aim without a single shot being fired. We have not yet fully wrapped our heads around the other three battlegrounds of China in the 21st century. Firstly, over a billion Indians who have been mired in ennui, did not bother to refrain from purchasing goods made in China. Hence, China knows very well that its grip over legitimately manufactured goods and global rip-offs will not be affected by the call of war. If the people of China do not care, why would the rest of the world bother? Even as I look around me, the TV, the mobile phone, the laptop, the coffee mug and toaster share a common genesis. The only panacea to achieve peace between Pakistan and India is finding a solution to the Kashmir issue, Foreign Minister Khawaja Asif said on Sunday. We know how to secure our borders, however, lasting peace can only be attained through solving the Kashmir issue, he said while speaking to media in Sialkot, according to Express News. The former defense minister said Pakistan's options become limited if India was not willing to meet us halfway. We want to dissipate tensions with India, but they are not willing to do the same, he added. Pakistan, he added, wants friendly relations with Afghanistan as well, but India must also play a part to make it a reality. Pakistan has been fighting the war on terror for a long time now, and the threat has decreased now owing to the great sacrifices made by the Pakistan Army, he said. Asif said peace between the two countries was intertwined with Kashmir dispute, and in light of the UN agreement, the people of Kashmir want the right to vote for self-determination. Our foreign policy will be in accordance with the wishes of the people, and in view of what is in the best interest of Pakistan, he said. Both countries want the continuity of the Indus Waters Treaty, however, any violation would worsen relations even further. Keen on boosting bilateral trade and ties, India and Iran have expressed commitment to operationalize the strategic Chabahar port at the earliest. Union Minister Nitin Gadkari, who is on a two-day visit to Tehran as a special envoy of India deputed by Prime Minister Narendra Modi at the inauguration of the second tenure of Hassan Rouhani as the President of Iran, extended the PM's invitation to Rouhani to visit India while handing over a letter of felicitation to him and held talks with him and other Iranian officials. Amid China's growing assertiveness in the South China Sea and on border disputes with neighbors, India on Sunday said that the 10-nation ASEAN bloc plays a central role in the security of the Asia-Pacific region. From the Indian perspective, ASEAN, Association of Southeast Asian Nations, occupies a central place in the security architecture of the Asia-Pacific region, Minister of State for External Affairs V.K. Singh said in his speech at the 15th ASEAN-India Foreign Ministers meeting in Manila, Philippines. It is our view that precisely because ASEAN represents the cultural, commercial, and physical crossroads of the region, it has a unique ability to reflect and harmonize larger interests of the world beyond it, he said. His comments came even as Indian and Chinese troops are in a tense standoff situation in the Sikkim sector of the international border since mid-June, with China claiming that the Doklam area is its territory and seeking withdrawal of Indian troops. New Delhi, however, wants pullout of troops of both sides. Singh's speech also came as India and the ASEAN, which comprises Brunei, Cambodia, Indonesia, Laos, Malaysia, Myanmar, the Philippines, Singapore, Thailand, and Vietnam, are marking the 25th year of a dialogue partnership. The Southern Naval Command, SNC, and the Naval Physical and Oceanographic Laboratory, NPOL, on Monday will jointly organize an event here to mark the successful completion of 200 scientific missions of InSAGARDHWANI, a marine acoustic research ship owned by NPOL. Rear Admiral R.J. Nadkarni, Chief of Staff, SNC, will be the chief guest at the function, which will be presided by NPOL Director S. Kedarnath Shenoy. A monograph highlighting the scientific contributions of InSAGARDHWANI over the past two decades and 200 scientific missions will be released to mark the occasion. The monograph takes a comprehensive look at the contributions of InSAGARDHWANI, which are important to our understanding of different aspects of anti-submarine warfare, ASW, research activities at NPOL, a release said here. InSAGARDHWANI is one of the first indigenously built oceanographic research ships. It is 85 m in length and 13 m in breadth. It was built by Garden Reach Shipbuilders and Engineers Ltd., Kolkata, and was commissioned on July 30, 1994. Operated and maintained by the Navy for DRDO, the ship is based at the Southern Naval Command, Kochi. A number of state-of-the-art scientific laboratories to support multidisciplinary studies make the ship the mainstay in oceanographic research for NPOL. Armament Research and Development Establishment, ARDE, conducted carriage trials followed by carriage and release trials, CRT, of 500 kg precision-guided high-speed low-drag, PGHSLD, and craft bomb during 22-30 May 2017 at Pokhran Range. Two weapons, one with sensors, telemetry, data logger for carriage trials and other with GPS and telemetry for CRT were carried out by 32 Ring AF Station Jodhpur. Two captive sorties with the weapon conducted for carriage trials. PGHSLD-500 fitted on station 05/06 was cleared up to flight envelope. The weapon carried Chem-500 data logger and various all the sensor data was logged and matched with design parameters. No physical looseness or mechanical damage was observed to the weapon after carriage trials. During release trials, weapon was released from an altitude of 5 km at 900 km per hour, TAS, to verify separation performance and to estimate stability. The separation event recorded with high-speed camera showed safe weapon separation and no rolling, pitching or yawing dynamics in the vicinity of the aircraft. The trials were conducted with the help of Aircraft and Systems Testing Establishment, AST, Software Development Institute, SDI, Regional Center for Military Airworthiness, RCMA, NASIC, Office of the Regional Aeronautical Quality Assurance, ORDACA, and Hindustan Aeronautics Limited. A large K-sponded rocket motor of 12T class was static tested successfully earlier at Advanced Center for Energetic Materials, ACEM, NASIC. The composite case rocket motor was designed and realized indigenously and belongs to the Mark III version. The main objective of the static test was to validate the design for optimized EPDM, ethylene propylene dienine monomer, M-class, rubber, insulation where a reduction of 80 kg was carried out compared to the Mark I version, and to evaluate the augmentation factors. The motor has a submerged nozzle with provision for actuation, which is also realized indigenously. Lockheed Martin on August 3 announced the first flight of a VH-92A configured test aircraft in support of the U.S. Marine Corps' VH-92A Presidential Helicopter Replacement Program. The July 28 flight signals the start of the 250-hour flight test program, which will take place at Lockheed Martin facilities in Owego, New York. The aircraft achieved its first flight, and later that same day completed a second flight at Sikorsky Aircraft in Stratford, Connecticut. Total flight time for the two sorties was 1 hour and included hover control checks, low-speed flight, and a pass of the airfield. This first flight of the VH-92A configured test aircraft is an important milestone for the program, said Spencer Ilani, Director VH-92A Program at Sikorsky. Having independently tested the aircraft's components and subsystems, we are now moving forward to begin full aircraft system qualification via the flight test program. Lockheed Martin Missile and Fire Control has been awarded a $161.4 million contract for the production of launch assemblies for the Army Tactical Missile System surface-to-surface missile, the Department of Defense announced on Wednesday. The contract is part of the Service Life Extension Program for aging components of the missile system. Work will be conducted at sites across the U.S. with an estimated completion date of February 3, 2020. The Army has already obligated $161.4 million in procurement funds for the program. The Army Tactical Missile System is a surface-to-surface guided missile deployed by the M270 MLRS and M142 HIMARS multiple launch rocket systems. It uses GPS and inertial guidance to strike point targets at long ranges with a high degree of accuracy.